Our God will be where God will be, with no constraints, no predictability. Our God lives where our God lives, and destruction has no power, and even death cannot stop the living. Our God will be born where God will be born, but there is no place to look for the one who comes to us. When God is ready, God will come, even to a God-forsaken place like the stable of Bethlehem. Watch, for you know not when God comes. Watch, that you might be found whenever, wherever God comes. Our gospel lesson today comes from Matthew chapter 24, verses 36 through 44. Please rise and if you're able to
how tired he was, and he got up to leave. Before he had gone more than a few steps, he turned around, ran back to the old woman, and gave her a hug. She gave him her biggest smile ever. When the boy opened the door to his own home a short time later, his mother was surprised by the look of joy on his face. And she asked him, "What did you do today that made you so happy?" And he replied, "I had lunch with God." But before his mother could respond, he added, "You know what? She's got the most beautiful smile I've ever seen." So radiant with joy, returned to her home. Her neighbor was stunned by the look of peace on her face, and she asked, "Well, what did you do today that made you so happy?" And she replied, "I ate Twinkies in the park with God." But before her neighbor responded, she added, "You know, he's much younger than I expected." You never know when God will appear right before your very eyes. And this is what the season of Advent is all about. It's about waiting and looking, listening, paying attention. It is about the coming of God. And though we cannot predict the day that or the hour that God will come, we can get ready for it. We can prepare room in our hearts and our lives for the coming of Christ. And it would be nice this year to spend the season of Advent waiting for the baby. But this first Sunday of Advent, we have been called to confront death and hope. Today's gospel passage from Matthew is part of a larger conversation about the destruction of Jerusalem. And as the disciples admire the temple in Jerusalem, Matthew's Jesus foretells a time of doom and chaos. He foretells a time that the temple and Jerusalem will be destroyed. And indeed, it is later destroyed by the Roman Empire. Jesus foretells the story of Jerusalem's destruction days before his own death. But we have to remember that all the stories in the Bible were written long after Jesus' death. And this story in particular was written during a very difficult time in history, filled with destruction and chaos. But during this time, the disciples were awaiting the second coming of Christ. They were waiting for his return, and they were trying to keep hope alive. This is why we light the candle of hope on the first Sunday of Advent. It is an act of sacred defiance to light a candle of hope in the midst of death and destruction and chaos. It is an act of sacred defiance to light a candle of hope in December, when we know that the nights are just going to get darker before the light returns. It is an act of sacred defiance to light a candle of hope, to say that even when our world may appear God forsaken, we know that Christ will come again. This is the gospel of hope. And I think that it's unfortunate that Matthew's story about the coming of Christ has been used to scare people. It has fueled the Left Behind books that many of us have read, and countless movies about the apocalypse and Armageddon. And truth be told, I think think Jesus himself could have been a little more helpful here. He could have used a different metaphor about his return, rather than the dreadful image of an intruder breaking into our homes in the middle of the night. How can we not be afraid of that? And because of this story and how people have used it, religious people, I believe, are afraid of what will happen when Christ comes back. Afraid. Think about that. Instead of being filled with excitement and hope about the coming of God, we are filled with dread and fear. But I honestly do not think that that was Jesus' intention. The Jesus that I know doesn't use the fear factor to get people to do the right thing. The Jesus that I know, that I hope we all know, uses the love factor to get us to do the right thing. And though his intention is not to scare us with the use of this metaphor, I do believe his intention is to jar us out of complacency, to get us to wake up and pay attention, to get us to not just go through the motions of our lives, but to be centered in your prayer, to remind us that there is hope because God is here. In our darkest nights, we can find hope because we know Christ is coming back, and that is good news. And we see here, many of us, if not all of us, have known dark nights of our own souls, haven't we? Today is World AIDS Day, and all over the world, people are taking time to talk about the pandemic of AIDS. It's been 33 years since a name was given to this disease, and we still do not have a cure for it. We observe World AIDS Day each year in part to say that AIDS isn't over, to say that there is economic injustice because some people have access. Some people have access to life-saving medication, but others do not, because they do not have the money, or they do not have health insurance. We observe World AIDS Day to demand that no one be regarded as indispensable, no matter their age, their race, ethnicity, gender, sexual identity, expression, gender identity, expression, and whether or not they have money. Do you know that it is MCC who gave the gift of the first International AIDS Vigil of Prayer to the world? 1986, MCC San Diego held a prayer service that later turned developed into World AIDS Day. Our own people were devastated by HIV and AIDS. And we observe it every year, December 1st. And according to a statement released just this weekend from MCC's advocacy network, it says, "We live in a world where the faces of AIDS are increasingly brown, stubbornly poor, and alarmingly female, and men who have sex with men. They are our faces. They are the faces of those that we love and care for. They must not be left behind." CT goes on to say that our faith is greater than AIDS. And And those of us who have witnessed the death of loved ones from AIDS do not have to give in to despair or fear. It is an act of sacred defiance to light a candle of hope in the midst of death and to say that AIDS will not have the final word because our God is bigger than AIDS. There's a story in the Hebrew scriptures about Moses who was supposed to keep his arms raised all day to ensure victory for his people. Got tired and his arms grew weary, two people from his clan came, stood on either side of him, and held up his arms for him. In our darkest nights, this is what we do for each other. We take turns holding one another's arms. In a profound sense, we ourselves usher in the second coming of Christ into this world. We try diligently as disciples to be Christ, to be like Christ in this world, to do what Christ would do. And in this sense, when we do that, Jesus returns every day. Whenever we offer hope, fight to end stigma and discrimination, Jesus returns. Whenever we see people caring for one another, we get glimpses of the glory of God. Whenever we hold up one another's arms, Jesus returns, and the promise of hope is born. The beginning of Advent invites us to hope for a different world. And don't we hope for a world that is free from AIDS? A world without racism and discrimination? A world where every person matters and everyone belongs? It is often said that during Advent, Christians should seek to newly birth Christ in the world. But what is first required is for Christians to simply incarnate themselves, for Christians to be utterly present in the world. Only when we are able to remain awake to the real sufferings and joys of the world can we hear God's call and act. That's a beautiful image of Christians incarnating ourselves to be like Christ in this world. And Advent is a time for centering ourselves so that we can be utterly what is happening in our lives. I think this is why I love the title to Anne Wein's book of poetry that we drew from this morning, called Kneeling in Bethlehem. Kneeling is an intentional act. It's getting into an intentional posture of receptivity and openness. And when we are kneeling, we are waiting. When God is ready. God will come, even to a God-forsaken place like a stable.